Shalom Chavrim, I'm Stephen Benoon. You're watching Israeli News Live, and today we have our very special guest, Brother Stephen Pidgeon from the United States. And I wanted to sit down with Brother Pidgeon, who is an attorney at law. He's actually has a couple of different doctorate degrees in this area here. But we have talked extensively about Russia, the conflict that is in Ukraine. We have looked at the tensions between NATO and that of Ukraine as well. And in light of this, Steve has a remarkable amount of information. I think that is a blessing. It'll be a blessing to you guys as well. And I know you'll appreciate and value that information. Steve, thank you for joining us here today.
I'm glad to be here.
And let's get right into it. We know, just as we were reporting this morning, there's a lot of things going on still yet. Obama is not backing off on sending the troops, the equipment to the Russian border. The largest thus far NATO drill has been done right there with in Lithuania with 10,000 NATO member troops going on there. And now, again, we see more information that he's sending even more tanks. 2,000 pieces of military hardware is being sent here to Europe. This is in an addition, Steve, already with all kinds of things that have been happening already. And we've been seeing military hardware going into Ukraine. That's something else that not many people are aware of. We've seen video footage of hardware going into Ukraine through Slovakia, people that have uploaded that. I got an email this morning, a friend of ours in Austria, who said to me just the other day, a train loaded with tanks and every other type of thing you could think of on there had just gone through Austria. And generally speaking, you think of Austria, you think of it maybe going to Ukraine. Of course, it could be going also to the front lines there, whether it be Poland, Lithuania, Estonia, Latvia, et cetera. But anyway, I want to get some of your knowledge in on the things that are happening.
Well, the arming of Ukraine is actually fairly well known in the United States. The United States Congress specifically approved funding for just exactly that, for arming the Ukrainian government. The difficulty here is that you have a government here that was really illegally installed. It was installed through auspices of revolution. There was no democratic process. The government in Ukraine actually has a substantial Nazi background. And the fact that it has a Nazi background and the deployment against Russia, the way it stands right now, going from Estonia at the far northern end, around, wrapping around all the way in, even into Georgia and Azerbaijan, is quite similar to the conditions that were found in 1941 when Germany was prepared to abort its commitment in the Ribbentrop-Molotov Treaty between Russia and the non-aggression treaty between Russia and Germany. Now, at that time, Adolf Hitler moved in 8 million troops and thousands of tanks that he placed in Ukraine. There were three significant battles that happened between Russia and Germany. One, of course, was in St. Petersburg, where the Russians lost 5 million men and the Germans a corresponding amount. One was in Stalingrad, which is now Volgograd. Again, you're talking about the loss of 5 million men on the sides, both sides. And, of course, the most significant battle of the war, which was actually fought fairly early on, was the tank battle on the other side of the Ukrainian-Russian border and near the city of Kursk, Russia. And this tank battle, featured the superior German panzer tanks against the inferior Russian tanks. But the Russian tanks, which were a surprise to the German forces, were faster, quicker, and there were a lot more of them. And at the end of the day, the whole panzer division was destroyed. And so when Hitler had placed 8 million troops on that border, by 1945, you had 18 million German war dead, and you had a Russian flag on the Reichstag. And so what is so alarming to the Russians is that the buildup here, the military buildup along the border, is so similar in tactics and strategy to what was seen during the tenure of the Third Reich in the 1940s. And the Russians lost 16 million men in that war. 16 million men they have never forgotten.
You know, you mentioned that right there. And there is an American guy that's there fighting alongside the Donetsk People's Republic. They call him Tex. You can find him easy on YouTube. And he has done a lot of good education for the American people that are following his program. But he doesn't get the word out well enough is the problem. But he went into that battle there. He's taken his camera there and has shown what is going, you know, what went on back during the war, during World War II. And the Russian people have never forgotten this. And now there have been, inside of Ukraine, there have been a lot of the neo-Nazis that are part of this coup that overthrew Yanukovych. They have been going through the country destroying the statues and things that were memorable to the Russians that died in the battle there. It's only putting salt in the wound to begin with. And, you know, on July the 8th, we had actually picked up the video footage of 40 tanks that were sent by the Ukrainians to the contact line in Donetsk. The whole world, Steve, none of them wanted to bring this out. BBC had actually followed our reports then. I was watching them tweet back and forth of what was going on. Then, of course, we picked up where the Russians also sent in more tanks to back up the Donetsk people there as well that are fighting in this proxy war between Russia and the United States. But it's only a matter of time before it's going to become more directly engaged. And there are, you know, Russia, they say they didn't send troops in. Russia still sends mercenaries in as well, just like the United States is sending in mercenaries. We see Blackwater has been involved under a different name now inside of Ukraine fighting. I have seen several video footages by news companies there in that region there that have actually seen American, obviously American soldiers, because their accent in English is clearly not Canadian. It's not, and it's definitely not English or Australian. So,
and the Russian or Ukrainian language skills are lacking.
Exactly.
Yeah, of course. You know, but the significance in Ukraine, and I think that most Americans don't understand, is that you have more or less a language divide in the country, so that the maybe 60-70% of Ukraine in the western section is a Ukrainian language speaking people, but there is a region in the far eastern section, the Donbass region, Donetsk, Luhansk, where the people are Russian-speaking, not only Russian-speaking, but most of them are of Russian ethnicity and even hold Russian passports. You had a similar situation in Crimea, although in Crimea, what you would find down there were primarily Russian Jews in the Crimean Peninsula. And also in the city of Odessa, you had a significant Jewish population. So when Poroshenko came to power, who has a substantial Nazi credential, a substantial Nazi credential. The first thing the government did was, of course, to issue an order, an edict, that the Jews must register. And it was for this reason that the 20,000 Jews in Odessa, who were outside of the area that was secured by Russia and Crimea, immediately appealed to Israel for help to escape the region. They were terrified. The Russian Jews living in Crimea immediately petitioned the Russians to come in and secure the area. And, of course, historically, Crimea has been a portion of Russia for hundreds of years, segregated only into the hands of Ukraine, and not really the nation of Ukraine following the breakup of the Soviet Union, but Ukrainian SSR, which was a subpolitical region of the Union of Soviet Socialist Republic back when the USSR was still going.
Well, you know, that brings out an interesting point as well. And this is one of the reasons why I wanted to talk to you, is because of the fact that Poroshenko wanted the Jews to actually register. And historically, especially under the dictators of Stalin and Lenin, the Jews didn't favor very well at all. But then again, that was a Jesuit invasion of the country. Since we have seen Vladimir Putin come into the country, we have seen his relationship between the Jewish people in Russia has become better, far better. He's actually visited synagogues. This has given Israel far better feelings. Avi Lipkin, who we had on when we were in Israel last, said that that Russia's relationship with the Jewish people is at an all-time high. And he even stated, and I take this into account when there's a lot of fears amongst a lot of the American Christians that are saying that, you know, Russia brought this huge flotilla down into the Mediterranean Sea, and they feel like this is Gog and Magog coming to take over and fight against Israel. The only way I could see that Russia would actually attack Israel at this point right here would be is if Putin was taken out of the picture altogether. I just don't see it at this point because he's...
There's one other scenario, and that is if Israel begins to move its F-15s into the theater in Syria.
Yes.
And that would cause Russian arms to turn. But, you know, Vladimir Putin grew up in a Jewish home, actually. He was adopted. He grew up in a Jewish home. And so he has some experience with the synagogue. But it's so interesting because Putin has moved so far from in the early 2000s when he was essentially still had kind of a Soviet mindset, if you will, coming out of the KGB. Now, for Americans who still cling to this idea of the evil empire, the KGB, and all of that, the KGB's been gone for 30 years. Okay, it's been gone for 30 years now. And Putin has moved out of this atheism. There was, you know, I was in Russia in the early 2000s, and there was a real sense of freedom because there was nothing. They'd come out of a complete economic collapse and starvation, actually. And so all of the apparatchiks had lost their jobs. The bureaucracies were all closed. And you saw people living in freedom in Russia. But as that freedom began to move forward, there was some interesting things happen. You see Vladimir Putin, for instance, at one point, he forced all the casinos that were on the Dverchenko prospect there in downtown Moscow, you know, or the Tverskaya, rather, you're out. You have to leave Moscow. You can't even be in the city at all. So he expelled the casinos from Moscow. That was a pretty significant move. I was shocked when I was in Moscow this last trip to see a whole modern city like the Crown of London. Boom, there it is right in the inner circle in Moscow that has been constructed. For, of course, commerce. But you have seen a turn in Vladimir Putin back to Russian orthodoxy.
Yes.
And not only has he turned back to orthodoxy, but the nation has turned back to orthodoxy. Now, there are many people in Russia who were so steeped in communism, they have no possibility of returning to the faith. But even when I talk to those people, well, you can talk to our kids. I would like my child to have an opportunity to faith. For me, it's hopeless. But for them, possible. But you see so many of the people in Moscow who haven't been taught anything have wandered back into orthodoxy, and in Russia. The nation was at one time 94% orthodox. Moscow had the single largest number of churches in the world. It still does. Well, you know, the top order of business of Yuri Lushkov, who was the mayor of Moscow in the 90s, was to restore the Church of Christ our Savior, a very significant white church on the Moscow River, where that Stalin had torn down to put up a Soviet a palace. And the first order of business for him was to rebuild that cathedral. So you see that the heart of Russia to restore itself to orthodoxy has happened. And now, it doesn't mean that there still isn't an element of intolerance for the Protestants, like the Baptist Union or the Protestant Union or a non-denominational union. Right. But I was just visiting an opening of a church in Gorsk that was a non-denominational church, and it was being widely celebrated in the city, and the government has sat and looked and watched this church go up with admiration.
Well, you know, it's good that you bring this out as well, because you just recently came from Russia, and I think it's important for the viewers to know that as well, because everybody's getting afraid. They say, well, Putin suddenly has brought in these laws to silence all or to take away freedom of religion. Maybe that would be the better way to put it. But in reality, I knew already that from historical view on this, the Tsars were taken out of power because the Vatican wanted to stop Eastern Orthodox religion. They wanted to conquer it. And the best way to do it was to bring in atheism. And then, of course, from my own wife's experience, I know that the only church that was accepted once they finally crushed as much as they could, and that was the Roman Catholic Church. Now, speaking of that, and then looking at Putin is not against a non-denominational church. He is cautious, I believe, because of knowing the history of his country, and he's a very good historian. He knows that the Roman Catholic Church had a major... was a major factor in the collapse of the Tsars of Russia that were was a godly nation at that time. Mm-hmm. And at the same token, at the collapse of the Soviet Union, we saw that there were 70 Eastern Orthodox churches in Ukraine as well. This is another thing a lot of people don't realize. And now that Ukraine has been once again under a war, under a civil war, it's all actually all about religion. A lot of people don't even realize that. They have no idea. You have Poroshenko and the prime minister that he had, I forget the guy's name now, but they met with the Pope of Rome. All this was going on in the background. People have no clue. On top of it, when the coup was going on, we have John McCain that actually goes to Ukraine. You have George Soros that goes there when this is all going on. All these figures that are coming from the United States, all of them backing the coup, you know, just throwing some gasoline on the fire, as it were. And according to the documentary that was done by Russia, even though it was a state-run documentary called Crimea, The Way Home, they pointed out and they show in their documentary this was a well-orchestrated coup, and it was done by a lot of people that were not even from the country. And they do also note the fact that they were done by neo-Nazis, pro-neo-Nazis, stir up the conflict in the country. And there again, it seems to be a conquering of Eastern Orthodox Christianity.
It really is. It's a spiritual war. Eastern Orthodoxy cannot be tolerated. And in particular, since the Eastern Orthodox, at least as represented or defended by Putin, has said there are certain values that will never be Russian values. For instance, same-sex marriage will never be a Russian value. It's just not on the table. It's not going to happen in Russia. It's not going to be promoted in Russia. And that's just the way it is. And, you know, if you go back to the Eastern Orthodoxy Church, remember that it was the Catholic Church that pulled out of what was the practice of Christianity in all of Orthodoxy, which really began in Alexandria. The methodology in Alexandria, which later went up to Constantinople, the Hagia Sophia, now the Red Mosque, all of that practice was continuous and the same, and it continued under Byzantium until 1453. Inside the Kremlin, there is this crown called the Crown of Montmartre, which shows that the crown of Byzantium went from Constantinople to Moscow following the fall of Constantinople to the Ottomans in 1453. And so Orthodoxy has been a continuing practice, even in Kyiv, where you have the Ukrainian Orthodox Church, even in Tbilisi, where you have the Georgian Orthodox, or in Yerevan in Armenia, where you have the Armenian Orthodox, and so on it goes. That you have these Orthodox churches that really continue a continuous and similar methodology of practice since the first century. Only the Catholics become aberrant to that, or aberrant to that, with their own methodology saying, we are not Orthodox, meaning correct, we are Catholic, meaning universal. And they have asserted the supremacy of Rome, really the political supremacy of Rome, over the church and over the world. And so this concept of Rome pushing forward with a new world order and its concept, now part and parcel of that concept is a preferred political methodology, which is, it used to be national socialism, now it's international socialism. But Adolf Hitler said that national socialism, that the Nazi ideology did not work so well in a Christian nation, would work far better in an Islamic nation. So the decision was made a long time ago. We're talking back in the 80s. The decision was made that as this new world order was imposed, that the underlying body politic would be moved over to Islam. This is why President Obama declared the United States to be an Islamic nation, why he went ahead and put Muslim Brotherhood members in his cabinet, the head of Homeland Security, the head of the CIA, all well-known Muslims. And so the protocol is to, of course, to convert the United States to an Islamic nation. The protocol is to require Europe to Islamicize, to become a completely Islamic area. Because, of course, the controls of Islam, which are brutal on the street, you know, women, of course, lose everything. And the enforcement is done by cutting off a hand, cutting off a leg, cutting off a head, dismembering. so that you get the kind of controls that you used to have in the 7th century. This is the desired effect because it can be managed cheaply. Anyway, when you're talking about the spiritual warfare here, absolutely, this is what is going on. You have the dark forces of the West going against what's left of the Christian light in the East and using Islam as its tool. Now, there's an economic aspect to this thing too, because you have two competing supply lines of natural gas to Europe. You know, no one wants to talk about the fact that the Russian company Gazprom had established its contracts by running 8 major pipelines through Ukraine, who was a partner state at that time as part of the Commonwealth of Independent States and the newly independent states of the Soviet Union. And they had their gas pipelines running through Ukraine. There was a couple of extras that went through Belarus into Poland, but for the most part, all the terminals are in Ukraine. And so this was well known in the West, and so if they could capture those terminals, now we can shut down Russian natural gas. But if you shut down Russian natural gas, you have to have an alternative. The alternative is, of course, Qatari, Saudi, UAE natural gas that would be fed up through the country. But remember, because Obama failed in Iraq, Bush had success, and Obama squandered that success, and the Shia in Iraq moved into an encampment with the Shia in Iran. This is a unified horn, if you will, the little horn. This unified horn of Shiite between Iran and Iraq. So, and then you had an Iranian minority government under Bashar al-Assad controlling mostly a Sunni country, but also where Christians and Jews also lived and enjoyed, domestic protection. Those countries now occupy a swath of land that goes from Iran all the way to the Mediterranean. Well, where do you put your pipeline? So they went to Assad and they said, we want to put our pipeline through Syria. And he said, no, war is on. Boom, just like that. Because in order to remove Russia from the equation of providing natural gas to Europe, we have to have a replacement. The replacement is Saudi Arabia, Qatar, and so forth. The same countries who put hundreds of millions of dollars in the hands of Hillary Clinton, that put hundreds of millions of dollars into the Clinton Foundation. In other words, they paid for this service. They want American politicians to respond. One of the politicians responding is Senator John McCain.
Now, I got a good, everything lines up more so now that you help bring the perspective in here, because we've talked about this on Israeli News Live many times already. We can back up and we can look at the when Vladimir Putin had offered Ukraine. This was during the time when Yanukovych was still the president of Ukraine at the time. He was still very much pro-Russian, that's where he's at now. He's living in Russia for the sake of his own life. But before the coup, Yanukovych was trying to, have his cake and eat it too. He was trying to make an agreement with the EU to become an EU member, which meant that he was going to take the deal of the gas lines. Of course, by the way, the Vatican has a major stake in those gas companies there. The Vatican is a major stockholder in Gulf International, Shell Oil, etc. And those companies all have the stakes in these areas, including in Syria, which a lot of people may not know. Qatar is one of the main places that they have, Qatar, where they have their stocks at. So this is why the Vatican's heavily involved in this. But what happened was Putin then turns around and offers a deal that was $15 million a year less than what the U.S. and the NATO backers were offering, not so much NATO in this case here, but as far as the IMF. EU members, right, they were offering their deal, which was far more expensive for the Ukrainian people, and they would have been footing the bill the rest of their lives trying to pay for all this gas here. And then when Russia offered to do it cheaper, because they already had the setup, everything's in place, this is when the coup began. And ironically, like you said, the same thing happens back in 2011. John Kerry is over there when it looked like they're going to have the deal to go through Syria, and he's trying to make peace between Syria and Israel, and suddenly the deal falls through and war breaks out. Now, oddly enough, Donald Trump, he selected his director for the CIA, Pompeo. Pompeo. Okay, Pompeo is who he has chosen for the director of CIA. Well, Pompeo was stating in an interview back, maybe 2012. I forget exactly the year he said this in, but he was stating in this interview, it couldn't have been then, because it must have been 2012, because the war is already going on in Syria. And he was for the toppling of Bashar al-Assad. He said, we have to topple Bashar al-Assad. He says, because we have a huge, enormous interest in Syria. Well, this is what he's talking about there, and that was the pipeline to come through Syria. So he had to have a regime change in order for this to happen. But the sad thing is, though, is Donald Trump, he doesn't want to topple Bashar al-Assad. He wants to allow the man to stay in power, which is the way it should be. You know, and he's backing with Russia on this. But
it's like a jaw has been placed, a hook has been placed in their jaw and is pulling them in. And they cannot resist the fight. And there's a passage in Scripture that says, it's like a fire that has started in the stubble. Who can put that out? The fire has started in the stubble, and it's well underway. And so what you see is the motion of the deep state in the United States is completely invested and is intransigent about what's going to happen. So now you get the transient leadership in the United States that apparently is going to change hands. And with that change in the leadership, can they manipulate the deep state to say, we want to unwind, we need to unwind? It's easy to look and see, we can see it, we want to order it, and theoretically that aspect exists. But the machine, you know, it's like an oil tanker. It takes 30 miles to get an oil tanker to stop once you give the command. 30 miles. And it's going to take a long time to unwind this. Now, the question is, will it be unwound before it explodes in war? Now, where John McCain is concerned, this is the thing that bothers me so much about this, is that you have this neocon faction, which is really being led by John McCain, a man who's been pictured with al-Baghdadi and the leadership in ISIS, a man who was on the ground putting boots on the funding and the deployment and the arming of ISIS by Hillary Clinton when she was at the State Department, who is the author of the refugee crisis in Europe, the author of the destruction of Libya, the author and a convicted war criminal in Egypt. So what you see is that they're claiming, we believe that we can engage in a limited nuclear war with Russia in Syria. Okay, the concept inside the House is, we can engage in a limited nuclear war with Russia in Syria. And of course, the decision was made back on October 1st that, okay, since we can't confront Russia directly, we're going to have to strike Assad directly, and we're going to have to strike him with such overwhelming force that really there's not Damascus left, because we want to make sure he doesn't escape. Enter Isaiah 17:1, where you have the complete destruction of Damascus. Who knew, Stephen, that it was going to be the United States that was going to do this?
This has been my argument all along right there. I mean, that is the thing that I have been hammering on, is that the United States, NATO, their allies are the ones doing it. I mean, even, and I know you know because I've spoken about this before, and I know you watch Israeli News Live quite a bit, but you're looking at so many scriptures that have been fulfilled, especially in light of Syria. You have Micah chapter 7, where it talks about, now this is actually a war that's dealing with Israel, but in the process of Micah 7, when it says that they will come to you over the mountains, from the sea, you know, from the river, etc., said, but notwithstanding the land where they're coming from, because it's talking about coming from Syria, the land will be desolate because of the deeds of those that are living there. And that's the civil war in Syria. You have the situation right now as we're watching, as Mosul is being just totally obliterated with the Iraqi forces and the American forces, which a lot of people don't even know. We've already lost a lot of American lives there. About a week ago, we'd already lost 16 American special forces that had already been killed there. Still not been made public in American news yet. 27 special forces have been wounded in this battle. And the other thing is that when you're dealing with Mosul, you're talking about Nineveh. That's where the ancient city of Nineveh is mm-hmm. in Mosul. Mm-hmm. And the prophecy of Nahum clearly says that they will flee from there, that it becomes a just a total wasteland. But before it became a wasteland, Nahum prophesied that they would first come, they would take all the prized possessions, the antiques, the chairs, the furniture, everything, and the silver and the gold. And Isis did all of this and sold it, and we find much of it over in Britain. So prophetically, everything is lining up. And like you said, who would think that it would be the United States? It would be the downfall of Damascus, which makes me wonder. Because in the leaked audio of John Kerry, when he was speaking to some of the Syrian operatives that they took to America once this outbreak, or once the war broke out, supposedly, I guess, people they would install in government once things settled down, that leaked audio, which, you know, I don't think it was leaked. I think it was done intentionally.
Oh, sure it is.
You know, he states in there that if we're going to take out Bashar al-Assad, we're going to have to do, if we're going to create a no-fly zone, he said, we're going to have to take out all of Russia's defense systems. And now we have Diego Garcia, which they still are trying to keep it from being public. You know, huge number of B-2
bombers,
etc.
Yeah, the massive deployment in Diego Garcia.
Yeah.
But the massive deployment in Diego Garcia is not necessarily about Russia.
Could be Iran.
Of course it's Iran, because one of the big secrets that no one will talk about is that while Iran was saying death to Israel, death to Israel, death to Israel, and justifying that as their military buildup, those missiles that they created, and I believe they showed people silos with 100,000 missiles in them.
Yes, they did.
That have some 1,500 kilometer range. Those missiles are actually aimed at Saudi Arabia. And you had the Iranians have put 1 million men under arms right now. If you recall in the war between Iraq and Iran in the early 80s, there were 1 million casualties experienced by Iran, 1 million dead soldiers. They have 1 million men under arms right now. The Saudis have put in the field 350,000 players. You remember this staging that happened here last year where the Saudis put 350,000
yes,
troops
on the southern border there of Syria.
Apache helicopters and yes. 10,000 tanks and F-16s. And I mean, from my point of view, not the most brilliant military strategy to take all of your troops and put them in one spot, you know, particularly in range.
Iran is watching them because Iran is backing Nasrallah. They're backing Bashar al-Assad because of the Shia connection.
And so I believe that the military buildup in Diego Garcia is concentrating on what the Iranians could possibly do, what the Iranians may do. And so the question is, when you're talking about the confrontation with Russia in Syria, there's a belief that the confrontation with Russia in Syria is going to be limited to Syria. I don't believe that at all.
I don't either.
And so what you're seeing happening is you're seeing a structure that is being created from Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, all the way down through to Azerbaijan. You're seeing a structure being put in place to put tanks, armament, troops. And remember that the deployment of troops is really not really a deployment of a specific number of troops, but it represents the establishment of a supply train into which multiple troops. If you look at that
yes.
deployment carefully, you see it's rapid deployment testing is what's going on.
Yes.
Rapid deployment. So they want to be able to do, you know, Britain puts 4,000 men in, but Britain will put all of Australia, all of Canada, all of New Zealand in there if you get into the far end of the war.
And they're drafting now as well. That's something else that we found out from Ivan Pernar, the MP for Croatia, that they have enacted the draft. They say Germany's been talking about it. I believe Germany's already done it. Slovenia.
Slovenia, yeah.
As well,
mm-hmm.
has done the same thing. Mm-hmm. Many of the nations are actually doing this now because they know they're going to need manpower. They're expecting this to be a long, drawn-out war.
That expectation, I believe, is a misplaced expectation, because the difference now between World War II and World War III is that the Russians have moved their munitions into a concentration on missiles and nuclear weapons.
Yes.
Period.
And
it's cheaper for them, and they have an edge.
That's the other thing as well. If you go back to the documentary, Crimea the Way Home, Putin states in this documentary, if we see we cannot win a ground war, we will opt to use nuclear weapons. He said it's always on the playing board. And we know he will, because Putin knows, although Putin, you know, Russia has a tremendous military, they do an excellent job, they're still outnumbered. NATO, as he says, it's a suicide to go against NATO. It'd be crazy to start a war with NATO. I don't think he ever would. But in Russian news about 2 months ago, we actually picked up on one article there that stated that, or it was more than 2 months ago, because they were talking about October. They said, we're really concerned that what NATO is planning is to take one of the Ukrainian Sukhois, give it the Russian markings, and have it come from east to west and hit the U.S. embassy, only to get to, so they get the Americans to say, okay, we have now, you know, they have struck the United States. We are at war with Russia, and then that's what would actually cause us all to go off. Now you mentioned Azerbaijan, and in countries like this here, we know that China and Russia both have moved a huge number of troops in their, I want to say,
Kazakhstan.
Kazakhstan. Yes, I was going to say, getting up in that area. So you have that. You have Serbia, Mongolia, all these places. Romania now, the MIMs from America. The, you know, the defense systems that they've put in there. They can also be used as cruise missile launchers. It's going nuts.
It is going nuts. It really is. And what you're seeing also is you're seeing, and of course, what you're not seeing is off the table rapid development of sophisticated systems and sophisticated technologies about which we do not know.
Well, see, Russia brought that out in the news yesterday. They're letting some things leak because they're trying to get America to wake up, to get the politicians to wake up. As Putin did the famous interview with all these journalists not long ago, a few months or 6 months, a year ago, whatever it was, and he sits down with them and he says, what do I do to get this through to your head? Yeah, and he knows the politicians won't listen.
And the answer is you can't get through to the media's head because they're not media. You know, in Russia, they used to have a saying during the Soviet Union, okay? Nie izvestia se izvestia, nie pravda se pravda. There is no news in izvestia. There is no truth in pravda. We have the same issue in the United States. All of these alphabet news agencies are, as this election has proven, are pure propaganda agencies. They do not engage in news. They engage in propaganda. And usually the first thing out of their mouth is the biggest lie they're going to tell for the night. So you have to keep that in mind. So talking to them and saying, can you expose this, is ridiculous.
Right, right.
And so he knows that. And I'm trying to wake up the American people. The American people are becoming awake, but they don't understand the scope of the threat from Russia. You know, Russia has 44,000 nuclear warheads deployed. Some of the materials that they have deployed are the heaviest weapons ever seen. Remember, the largest nuclear bomb to ever detonate was a 67-megaton bomb called Tsar Bomba. Huge bomb. They thought it was going to split the Earth in half. 67 megaton. They have created a weapon now called Satan II that has 100-megaton capability, can take out all of Texas in one with one missile, all of Germany with one missile, all of France with one missile, the Satan II. Yes. They just developed a new missile called the SAMSAT that they're deploying now, 440 kiloton, travels at 4.5 miles per second, can reach London in 18 minutes. If that bomb goes off over the top of London, Paris will experience damage. If it goes off over London.
Well, speaking of that, now they have a new technology they just came out with, or they're at least they're expressing what they have. They said Satan II is nothing compared to our other one called Demon. And they said it's based on a totally different type of physics in the way that this bomb is used. They actually show a picture of it as they're loading it onto one of the trucks there. It is portable, it's mobile. Russia has been moving down. We were able to pick up from a guy living in Russia who shared with me, and I talked to him personally, that Russia has been moving they've been moving extra nuclear warheads into the silos in the area where he lives at in Russia. He said they're getting very serious here about what they're going to do. So Russia is preparing for a nuclear confrontation with the West, and I'm afraid that a lot of people don't realize just how serious this is. And then on top of it, a good friend of mine, his grandfather worked for Hitler. He was a scientist during World War II. He said that when they were working, he said, we had developed a weapon. He said they would make the nuclear bomb look like nothing. Cobalt would be nothing compared to this one here. And he talked about that the technology, as you said earlier, about this one nuclear bomb being able to split the Earth open. That's what he said. If the bomb is released, this bomb will literally split the crust of the Earth open to where the lava would come out. During the war, and he shared this information with me that his grandfather told him, because now he was taken into America. The Americans took him in as a scientist there. But he said right before the war ended, Hitler moved this technology, and the bombs they had created from this, and it was put into the catacombs under the Vatican. Mm. Imagine
mm-hmm.
that.
Mm-hmm. Well, again, what you see is there is a lot of weaponry, and I can tell you that the Russian intent, if you're living in Russia and you're looking at this massive troop buildup and you're looking at thousands of smaller nuclear weapons, you know, the 20 kiloton type nuclear weapons, some of which have already been used in Syria, some of which have already been used in
yes.
Yemen. You look at some of those smaller nukes that are being put into the area, those are tactical nuclear weapons designed to take out tank movements and the front line of troop movements coming in over a border. Okay. So far, everybody's saying, we're just defensive. But if a war breaks out, the Russians are going to be looking and saying, okay, you know, we had Napoleon come in here, and we had Hitler come in here. And when Napoleon came into Russia, and he advanced with his 2 million men on Moscow, the Russians burned Moscow to the ground and left. They all went out to their dachas or wherever it is that they went. But they burned it to the ground and left and said, here you go. Here's your city. And then the French tried to live in Moscow with no supplies, no place to live, no food, no nothing, through a Russian winter. And the French soon discovered that the Russian winter is infinitely different than the French winter.
Yes.
Or the German winter. And the Battle of Volgograd, or the Battle of Stalingrad, when the Germans had gone down there, you know, they stalled the Germans at Stalingrad for years. And it was just a slugfest. 5 million dead on both sides. Finally, General Zhukov builds thousands of tanks right across the river. And the Germans couldn't see it because they'd been in this slugfest for so long. And he comes around and cuts off their supply lines. And he cut off the supply lines. Now, he could have said surrender. But he didn't. Instead, he said winter. Don't surrender. Winter. Enjoy the Russian winter. And he let the German troops sit there with no supplies for 8 months. The surrender was ignominious. Ignominious. Okay? Now, I'm not telling you that the Russians are going to win or anything else, and I'm not taking a side in this war. But what I am saying is that if this war breaks out, to think that you can limit the war to some kind of limited nuclear exchange in Syria, where you destroy all of the Russian systems that have been deployed in order to kill one man, Bashar al-Assad, because you can't figure out another way to deploy natural gas into Europe except through Syria, right?
It's all a matter of greed. It's not that the fact they couldn't do it another way. It's the money they would have to spend to go a different route, going through Turkey instead and bypassing Syria altogether. It's all about greed. And of course, speaking of that, in 2013, Bashar al-Assad sent a letter to Pope Francis on the conditions he would surrender. That blew me away. If he's at war, through a civil war in his country, knowing the United States is backing this, these rebels and all these different fighting factions there, Russia had not come in at that time to help him out other than to supply him with the weapons and things that he has need of. Why is he writing the Pope of Rome and giving him the terms that he will surrender for?
Mm-hmm. Because he knows of the tripartite arrangement of the leadership in the world. You know, the Vatican manages things spiritual. London manages things financial. Washington, D.C. manages things militarily. The Crown in London, Washington, D.C., and the Vatican are three independent nations within a nation. They're outside the scope of the
exactly.
nation. And so you have this interesting level of control. And one question for Americans is, exactly what is the spirituality that's going on in the Vatican? And, you know, we ask the rhetorical question, is the Pope Catholic? I mean, it's just a question. But when you look at what's happening in Syria where Bashar al-Assad is, you see, now it's no more, not even about Bashar al-Assad. It is about this machine is in motion. Can we make it stop? And I believe the answer is we can't make it stop. And I think if Americans knew the result of this failed policy, America had no national interest in Syria whatsoever. We had no national interest in Libya whatsoever. None. But we went in, and there was never a vote taken in Congress to put our troops in there, and there has never been a War Powers Act notice that we're there fighting. And so the great irony is that you have Hillary Clinton fund, arm, train, and deploy ISIS into the field, and those very same troops are now killing American special ops in Mosul.
Yes.
So who's fighting who here? The DOD is fighting the CIA. There's no civil war between Syria. There's a civil war between America, and it's going on offshore. Now, the civil war is coming home to America. But as the civil war comes home to America, keep in mind this. If they are wrong in their calculation that this is going to be a limited nuclear exchange in Syria, what does the world look like? Well, it goes from a limited nuclear exchange to a full-bore thermonuclear exchange.
Yes.
And keep in mind, our ICBMs are ancient teetering devices sitting in silos where the guys have long since, you know, if you're a private sad sack, we'll ship you out to watch one of those silos. You know those silos run on a 5.5-inch floppy disk drive? You know, through some 64K RAM cache, right?
How many of them will end up not going off in retaliation? I mean, we're America, and the sad thing is, Putin has warned over and over and over and over to the people. Just like when he was in Crimea and he brought his systems there, he kept the United States from taking Crimea. He says in that documentary, Crimea, The Way Home, I intentionally put the S-300 systems out where I knew their satellites could see it. He said, my point was to get them to back off. He said, we locked on to their ships.
Mm-hmm. I know.
Because he said they were coming in and they weren't going to back off.
And there were 90-something nuclear-tipped cruise missiles on board that vessel.
A lot of people don't know these things.
Yeah, there was some serious impact that was being intended to be used against Russia. I mean, it was very, and again, you have Senator John McCain, who is not informed. And I can tell you that even the upper echelons of the U.S. Navy are not informed. They don't know what the S-300 can do, what the S-400 and the S-500 can do. And they're blundering, and let's move the fleet in there and send in the F-18s and deploy that asset and let's pound them, you know. Then, only then did they find out, oh, they have S-400s in the field. Well, what does that mean? Well, let's see, 75,000-pound payload that has a 750-kilometer range that moves at Mach 10 at 100 feet above sea level.
And you're not going to knock it down.
You can't knock it down. You can't even see it. And when you can see it, when it breaks the horizon, from the time it breaks the horizon, if you do see it, and you say it's incoming, it's coming in at 100 feet, you have 45 seconds before impact. Yes. And before it gets there, it's deploying. It deploys a half a dozen decoys on either side, and they're all bouncing like this. At Mach 10, the new missile technology, and bear in mind, that our missiles are ICBMs, you know, you're talking less than Mach 2, okay? So even if we launched everything we had and assuming that they worked and they were all 100% efficient, which I think is really begging the question, they would be easily shot out of the sky, easily shot. So in America, you have this reliance. Well, we have anti-missile systems. We have these new laser anti-missile systems. Laser anti-missile systems that are all what? Digitally based systems.
Yeah, one EMP and they won't work at all.
Nothing will work. The whole country
and
shut down.
Think about this, not only that, think about our F-16s, practically any of our bombers, and et cetera, but especially the F-16s. This is all Chinese technology that is inside the planes to begin with. The chips are ran by the Chinese. What if the Chinese enter into the conflict and they decide to hack this system? Next thing you know, you got planes falling out of the sky.
And any of this is, and the same thing with the F-35, which is a total disaster. It's a disaster of a design. It's a disaster of a plane. And the only one who's ever built it successfully is China, who has a whole fleet of it. You know, so, I mean, the absurdity of it all. And so people do not understand how far behind we are militarily. And so we advanced tanks into the field, and we advanced artillery into the field like we're fighting World War II again. This isn't going to be World War II.
No.
And so if the neocons advance in Ukraine, and they say, and the most alarming thing in Ukraine, Stephen, is that they have expressed the Orange Revolution leadership that was engineered by George Soros, the Orange Revolution. That Orange Revolution leadership has become genocidal.
Yes, they have.
They have openly expressed, we intend to kill all of the Russian-speaking, all of the Russian nationals in Ukraine. That's genocide. Now, Americans need to understand this. We're going to come alongside a regime that has a Nazi legacy, that has openly expressed a genocidal intention, and our U.S. Congress has directly funded it.
Yes.
Talk to me about the moral issue associated with that.
And the thing is, this is what they're doing everywhere. It has become a genocide. And this is what happened that a lot of people have no idea about in Ukraine. And I've sat down with people that I know from there. Yana's father-in-law is Ukrainian. I mean, her dad is Ukrainian. But I have spoke with the people, and the genocide that they were doing against the Russians, not to mention the audio that was intercepted from the U.S.-Ukrainian embassy that was going back and forth between those soldiers that were in Crimea as well. And this was what they were speaking about, to wipe out every single Russian-speaking Ukrainian. And, of course, many of those are Jews as well, as you said. Mm-hmm. So why else would the Ukrainians then have the Jews register with the government if it wasn't for intent to find, track down, and kill all the Jews?
Sure, you start with the registration, and then you begin the roundup, and then you begin the slaughter.
Exactly.
You know, alarmingly, in the United States, someone has just said that the Trump supporters need to, quote-unquote, get ready for the urn. Well, you know, the urn implies ashes.
Yes,
the
I know.
The ashes imply a crematorium. And so you see that even in the United States, we have this same genocidal intent being expressed.
Yes.
And it's being expressed behind a color revolution, i.e. in the United States, the purple revolution. And so you see that you have a whole series of forces now that are at work in the United States. Civil war, revolution, and world war. All while the deep state is got its fingernails clawing on the cliff, trying to hold together the petrodollar and our commitments to our single largest funding agent, Saudi Arabia.
And you know one thing that it concerns me, and just kind of closing this up right now, when we look across the sea and we look at America, and we see the good old boys, as we call it in America, that have armed themselves pretty much with shotguns. I mean, I know that some of them buy the M16s, but these are all semi-automatic. They're not fully automatic, etc. But now we're having in America all kinds of shipment of weapons that have been coming into the country different ways. This purple revolution, if they get a hold of this type of weapons and stuff, the good old boys in America are going to be majorly outgunned. And, of course, then they're going to blame it all on the Arabs. And I'm sure many of them will be involved in that because, Obama has not just smuggled them in, he's brought them in by the tens of thousands, not to mention the African Muslims that have come in as well, that they put in between all the different groups of African Americans there because they just blend in. They can speak English as well from Africa. Many different nations are English speaking, mm-hmm. But no one's putting two and two together. They see mm-hmm. the protests on the streets. They see mm-hmm. the violence all of a sudden that happens. They figure, oh, the black people are just going crazy. Well, I knew for a fact that Washington, from the source that I had said there, said we can't get the black people to rise up and cause a riot in this nation. So they shipped them in to make sure that they could get the ones that would incite and do that. And I'm afraid that's what America is about to come to. And that might be the time. One thought I want to just throw in here, too, in closing, to get a closing thought from you on this as well, Steve, is that while America is sending all of her tanks, all of her armored personnel carriers, all of her grad launchers, et cetera, all are being shipped out of the United States, sent all over here to the Europe theater, and suddenly a civil war breaks out in America, and a war breaks out in Europe, say, for example, with NATO going up against Russia, America now has really weakened herself to a point to where what does she have at home to defend herself if, one, a civil war breaks out and weakens the nation through civil war, and suddenly now China and Russia say, well, while they're over here trying to kill us all over here, they've been preparing to do an invasion. And I've always been concerned about that, especially with Russia's buildup up there on the North Pole, the Arctic region there, the North Pole region there, because they could come easily right over through Alaska and right on down in.
Oh, sure. They practiced with the seven divisions and have already made landings, actual landings in Alaska, without any blowback. They've been able to put troops on the ground in Alaska.
Wow.
Because Obama has debilitated the military defense system up there. You know, I grew up in Alaska. We used to confront Russian aircraft almost 100 times a year, you know, bear bombers and MiG fighters,
right,
and et cetera, that we used to have to confront. But there used to be a contingent of F-22s at Elmendorf, and as soon as Obama got done fighting Sarah Palin, because of the things she said during the campaign, he pulled it all out. He pulled all of the strong assets, pulled it out of Alaska, and just said, whatever. And so you really do have a nakedness. Now, in the United States, when you talk about this revolution, I wrote about this revolution actually yesterday and wrote about it extensively, that you could easily see situations like what you saw in Mosul and what you saw in Aleppo taking place in Phoenix or in Dearborn, Michigan, or in Chicago, where you actually see an ISIS stronghold begin to be formed, and there's no assets to go in there and take it out. And even when the federal government comes in with helicopters or whatever, they accidentally bomb wrong targets like they've been doing in Iraq. And they actually hit National Guard or domestic forces that would be trying to go in and unearth this problem. So you end up with real strongholds of ISIS in major American cities that are now capable of inflicting serious casualties on well-trained and well-developed forces. In the meantime, what we've seen a great deal of in the United States, which you may not have seen, are these, what they call the MRAP, and these fortified Hummers. They're armored vehicles, they're armored
same
personnel
pictures
characters,
of those, yes.
Where you can deploy a 50 caliber on top, and they're structurally very, very strong, and you can put, you know, a dozen men inside of them. And we've seen hundreds of these being deployed in white UN colors. Primarily in the largest contingent have been in Atlanta and in the Washington, D.C. area and Maryland, and of course in Denver. So you have basically the three nerve centers for the federal government, which are going to be defended by UN troops in the blue helmets using these MRAPs. And so the rest of the country is basically going to be on its own. And so when you have a group of people who have experienced such severe brainwashing, where they were called to this purple revolution and they were going to stand up and do this, and they had an expectation, first of all, that Bernie Sanders was going to bring communism to bear. Everybody was going to get a free education, free medical care, a free job, and live in, you know, they have no idea what it is to live under communism, where you live in a rat hole and you're eating barely nothing. And they say, this is what you need. Now get in line for 10 hours to get a half a pound of green beans that somebody called coffee, and maybe once a year get some meat. That's what the state believes you need. But they think they're going to live like Denmark, or they're going to be all sipping coffee on a cafe in Holland.
They're going to live in little bitty boxed apartments. They're going to, as Jana used to tell me about, you know, that when you worked, your paycheck was 5 pounds of sugar for the month, so many pounds of flour for the month. That was your paycheck under communism.
Yeah.
So they have no idea what they're coming to. And the ironic thing is in Europe, many of the people here live in little tiny apartments that is not much bigger than most people's living rooms in America. And then that includes their kitchen. I've seen entire families. Jana comes from this type of family. She lived there.
Damascus left because we want to make sure he doesn't escape. Enter Isaiah 17:1, where you have the complete destruction of Damascus. Who knew, Stephen, that it was going to be the United States that was going to do this?
This has been my argument all along right there. I mean, that is the thing that I have been hammering on, is that the United States, NATO, their allies are the ones doing it. I mean, even, and I know you know because I've spoken about this before, and I know you watch Israeli News Live quite a bit, but you're looking at so many scriptures that have been fulfilled, especially in light of Syria. You have Micah chapter 7, where it talks about, now this is actually a war that's dealing with Israel. But in the process of Micah 7, when it says that they will come to you over the mountains, from the sea, you know, from the river, etc., said, but notwithstanding the land where they're coming from, because it's talking about coming from Syria, the land will be desolate because of the deeds of those that are living there. And that's the civil war in Syria. You have the situation right now as we're watching, as Mosul is being just totally obliterated with the Iraqi forces and the American forces, which a lot of people don't even know. We've already lost a lot of American lives there. About a week ago, we'd already lost 16 American special forces, had already been killed there, still not been made public in American news yet. 27 special forces have been wounded in this battle. And the other thing is that when you're dealing with Mosul, you're talking about Nineveh. That's where the ancient city of Nineveh is mm-hmm. in Mosul. Mm-hmm. And the prophecy of Nahum clearly says that they will flee from there, that it becomes a disaster, just a total wasteland. But before it became a wasteland, Nahum prophesied that they would first come, they would take all the prized possessions, the antiques, the chairs, the furniture, everything, and the silver and the gold. And ISIS did all of this and sold it, and we find much of it over in Britain. So prophetically, everything is lining up. And like you said, who would think that it would be the United States that would be the downfall of Damascus, which makes me wonder. Because in the leaked audio of John Kerry, when he was speaking to some of the Syrian operatives that they took to America once this outbreak, or once the war broke out, supposedly, I guess, people they would install in government once things settled down, that leaked audio, which, you know, I don't think it was leaked. I think it was done intentionally.
Oh, sure it is.
You know, he states in there that if we're going to take out Bashar al-Assad, we're going to have to do, if we're going to create a no-fly zone, he said, we're going to have to take out all of Russia's defense systems. And now we have Diego Garcia, which they still are trying to keep it from being public. You know, huge number of B-2
bombers,
etc.
Yeah, the massive deployment in Diego Garcia.
Yeah.
But the massive deployment in Diego Garcia is not necessarily about Russia.
Could be Iran.
Of course it's Iran, because one of the big secrets that no one will talk about is that while Iran was saying death to Israel, death to Israel, death to Israel, and justifying that as their military buildup, those missiles that they created, and I believe they showed people silos with 100,000 missiles in them.
Yes, they
that
did.
Have some 1,500 kilometer range. Those missiles are actually aimed at Saudi Arabia. And you had the Iranians have put 1 million men under arms right now. If you recall in the battle between, in the war between Iraq and Iran in the early 80s, there were 1 million casualties experienced by Iran, 1 million dead soldiers. They have 1 million men under arms right now. The Saudis have put in the field 350,000 players. You remember the staging that happened here last year where the Saudis put 350,000
yes,
troops?
Yes, on the southern border there of Syria.
Apache helicopters and
yes.
10,000 tanks and F-16s. And I mean, from my point of view, not the most brilliant military strategy to take all of your troops and put them in one spot. You know, particularly in range.
Iran is watching them because Iran is backing, naturally, they're backing Bashar al-Assad because of the Shia connection.
And so I believe that the military buildup in Diego Garcia is concentrating on what the Iranians could possibly do, what the Iranians may do. And so the question is, when you're talking about the confrontation with Russia in Syria, there's a belief that the confrontation with Russia in Syria is going to be limited to Syria. I don't believe that at all.
I don't either.
And so what you're seeing happening is you're seeing a structure that is being created from Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, all the way down through to Azerbaijan. You're seeing a structure being put in place to put tanks, armament, troops. And remember that the deployment of troops is really not really a deployment of a specific number of troops, but it represents the establishment of a supply train into which multiple troops. If you look at that
yes.
deployment carefully, you see it's rapid deployment testing. Is what's going on.
Yes.
Rapid deployment. So they want to be able to do, you know, Britain puts 4,000 men in, but Britain will put all of Australia, all of Canada, all of New Zealand in there if you get to the into the far end of the war.
And they're drafting now as well. That's something else that we found out from Ivan Pernar, the MP for Croatia, that they have enacted the draft. They say Germany's been talking about it. I believe Germany's already done it. Slovenia.
Slovenia, yeah.
As well
mm-hmm.
has done the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Many of the nations are actually doing this now because they know they're going to need manpower. They're expecting this to be a long drawn out war.
That expectation, I believe, is a misplaced expectation, because the difference now between World War II and World War III is that the Russians have moved their munitions into a concentration on missiles and nuclear weapons.
Yes.
Period.
And
it's cheaper for them, and they have an edge.
That's the other thing as well. If you go back to the documentary, Crimea the Way Home, Putin states in this documentary, if we see we cannot win a ground war, we will opt to use nuclear weapons. He said it's always on the playing board. And we know he will, because Putin knows, although Putin, you know, Russia has a tremendous military, they do an excellent job, they're still outnumbered. NATO, as he says, it's a suicide to go against NATO. It'd be crazy to start a war with NATO. I don't think he ever would. But in Russian news about 2 months ago, we actually picked up on one article there that stated that, or it was more than 2 months ago, because they were talking about October. They said we're really concerned that what NATO is planning is to take one of the Ukrainian Sukhois, give it the Russian markings, and have it come from east to west and hit the U.S. embassy, only to get to, so they get the Americans to say, okay, we have now, you know, they have struck the United States. We are at war with Russia, and then that's what would actually cause us all to go off. Now you mentioned Azerbaijan, and in countries like this here, we know that China and Russia both have moved a huge number of troops in their, I want to say,
Kazakhstan.
Yeah, Kazakhstan. Yes, I was going to say, getting up in that area. So you have that. You have Serbia, Mongolia, all these places. Romania now, the MIMs from America. The, you know, the defense systems that they've put in there. They can also be used as cruise missile launchers. It's going nuts. It's going nuts.
It really is. And what you're seeing also is you're seeing, and of course, what you're not seeing is off the table rapid development of sophisticated systems and sophisticated technologies about which we do not know.
Well, see, Russia brought that out in the news yesterday. They're letting some things leak because they're trying to get America to wake up, to get the politicians to wake up. As Putin did the famous interview with all these journalists not long ago, a few months or 6 months, a year ago, whatever it was, and he sits down with them and he says, what do I do to get this through to your head? Yeah, and he knows the politicians won't listen.
And the answer is you can't get through to the media's head because they're not media. You know, in Russia, they used to have a saying during the Soviet Union, okay? Nie izvestia se izvestia, nie pravda se pravda. There is no news in izvestia. There is no truth in pravda. We have the same issue in the United States. All of these alphabet news agencies are, as this election has proven, are pure propaganda agencies. They do not engage in news. They engage in propaganda. And usually the first thing out of their mouth is the biggest lie they're going to tell for the night. So you have to keep that in mind. So talking to them and saying, can you expose this, is ridiculous.
Right, right.
And so he knows that. And I'm trying to wake up the American people. The American people are becoming awake, but they don't understand the scope of the threat from Russia. You know, Russia has 44,000 nuclear warheads deployed. Some of the materials that they have deployed are the heaviest weapons ever seen. Remember, the largest nuclear bomb to ever detonate was a 67-megaton bomb called Tsar Bomba. Huge bomb. They thought it was going to split the Earth in half. 67-megaton. They have created a weapon now called Satan II that has 100-megaton capability, can take out all of Texas in one with one missile, all of Germany with one missile, all of France with one missile, the Satan II. They just developed a new missile called the SAMSAT that they're deploying now, 440 kiloton, travels at 4.5 miles per second, can reach London in 18 minutes. If that bomb goes off over the top of London, Paris will experience damage. If it goes off over London.
Well, speaking of that, now they have a new technology they just came out with, or they're at least they're expressing what they have. They said Satan II is nothing compared to our other one called Demon. And they said it's based on a totally different type of physics in the way that this bomb is used. They actually show a picture of it as they're loading it onto one of the trucks there. It is portable, it's mobile. Russia has been moving down. We were able to pick up from a guy living in Russia who shared with me, and I talked to him personally, that Russia has been moving they've been moving extra nuclear warheads into the silos in the area where he lives at in Russia. He said they're getting very serious here about what they're going to do. So Russia is preparing for a nuclear confrontation with the West, and I'm afraid that a lot of people don't realize just how serious this is. And then on top of it, a good friend of mine, his grandfather worked for Hitler. He was a scientist during World War II. He said that when they were working, he said, we had developed a weapon. So they would make the nuclear bomb look like nothing. Cobalt would be nothing compared to this one here. And he talked about that the technology, as you said earlier, about this one nuclear bomb being able to split the Earth open. That's what he said. If the bomb is released, this bomb will literally split the crust of the Earth open to where the lava would come out. During the war, and he shared this information with me that his grandfather told him, because now he was taken into America. The Americans took him in as a scientist there. But he said right before the war ended, Hitler moved this technology and the bombs they had created from this, and it was put into the catacombs under the Vatican. Imagine that.
Well, again, what you see is there is a lot of weaponry, and I can tell you that the Russian intent, if you're living in Russia and you're looking at this massive troop buildup and you're looking at thousands of smaller nuclear weapons, you know, the 20 kiloton type nuclear weapons, some of which have already been used in Syria, some of which have already been used in Yemen. You look at some of those smaller nukes that are being put into the area, those are tactical nuclear weapons designed to take out tank movements and the front line of troop movements coming in over a border. Okay, so far everybody's saying we're just defensive. But if a war breaks out, the Russians are going to be looking and saying, okay, you know, we had Napoleon come in here, and we had Hitler come in here. And when Napoleon came into Russia, and he advanced with his 2 million men on Moscow, the Russians burned Moscow to the ground and left. They all went out to their dachas or wherever it is that they went, but they burned it to the ground and left and said, here you go, here's your city. And then the French tried to live in Moscow with no supplies, no place to live, no food, no nothing, through a Russian winter. And the French soon discovered that the Russian winter is infinitely different than the French winter.
Yes.
Or the German winter. And the Battle of Volgograd, or the Battle of Stalingrad, when the Germans had gone down there, you know, that was they stalled the Germans at Stalingrad for years. And it was just a slugfest. 5 million dead on both sides. Finally, General Zhukov builds thousands of tanks right across the river. The Germans couldn't see it because they'd been in this slugfest for so long. And he comes around and cuts off their supply lines. And he cut off the supply lines. Now, he could have said surrender, but he didn't. Instead, he said, winter. Don't surrender. Winter. Enjoy the Russian winter. And he let the German troops sit there with no supplies for 8 months. The surrender was ignominious. Ignominious. Okay? Now, I'm not telling you that the Russians are going to win or anything else, and I'm not taking a side in this war. But what I am saying is that if this war breaks out, to think that you can limit the war to some kind of limited nuclear exchange in Syria, where you destroy all of the Russian systems that have been deployed in order to kill one man, Bashar al-Assad, because you can't figure out another way to deploy natural gas into Europe except through Syria, right?
It's all a matter of greed. It's not that the fact they couldn't do it another way. It's the money they would have to spend to go a different route, going through Turkey instead and bypassing Syria altogether. It's all about greed. And of course, speaking of that, in 2013, Bashar al-Assad sent a letter to Pope Francis on the conditions he would surrender. That blew me away. If he's at war through a civil war in his country, knowing the United States is backing this, these rebels and all these different fighting factions there, Russia had not come in at that time to help him out other than to supply him with the weapons and things that he has need of. Why is he writing the Pope of Rome and giving him the terms that he will surrender for?
Mm-hmm. Because he knows of the tripartite arrangement of the leadership in the world. You know, the Vatican manages things spiritual. London manages things financial. Washington, D.C. manages things militarily. The Crown in London, Washington, D.C., and the Vatican are three independent nations within a nation. They're outside the scope of the
exactly.
nation. And so you have this interesting level of control. And one question for Americans is, exactly what is the spirituality that's going on in the Vatican? And, you know, we ask the rhetorical question, is the Pope Catholic? I mean, it's just a question. But when you look at what's happening in Syria, where Bashar al-Assad is, you see, now it's no more, not even about Bashar al-Assad. It is about this machine is in motion. Can we make it stop? And I believe the answer is we can't make it stop. And I think if Americans knew the result of this failed policy, America had no national interest in Syria whatsoever. We had no national interest in Libya whatsoever, none. But we went in, and there was never a vote taken in Congress to put our troops in there, and there has never been a War Powers Act notice that we're there fighting. And so the great irony is that you have Hillary Clinton fund, arm, train, and deploy ISIS into the field, and those very same troops are now killing American special ops in Mosul.
Yes.
So who's fighting who here? The DOD is fighting the CIA. There's no civil war between Syria. There's a civil war between America, and it's going on offshore. Now, the civil war is coming home to America. But as the civil war comes home to America, keep in mind this. If they are wrong in their calculation that this is going to be a limited nuclear exchange in Syria, what does the world look like? Well, it goes from a limited nuclear exchange to a full-bore thermonuclear exchange.
Yes.
And keep in mind, our ICBMs are ancient teetering devices sitting in silos where the guys have long since, you know, if you're a private SADSAC, we'll ship you out to watch one of those silos. You know those silos run on a 5.5-inch floppy disk drive? You know, through some 64K RAM cache, right?
How many of them will end up not going off in retaliation? I mean, we're America, and the sad thing is, Putin has warned over and over and over and over to the people. Just like when he was in Crimea and he brought his systems there, he kept the United States from taking Crimea. He says in that documentary, Crimea, The Way Home, I intentionally put the S-300 systems out where I knew their satellites could see it. He said, my point was to get them to back off. He said, we locked on to their ships.
Mm-hmm. I know.
Because he said they were coming in and they weren't going to back off.
And there were 90-something nuclear-tipped cruise missiles on board that vessel.
And a lot of people don't know these things.
Yeah, there was some serious impact that was being intended to be used against Russia. I mean, it was very, and again, you have Senator John McCain, who is not informed. And I can tell you that even the upper echelons of the U.S. Navy are not informed. They don't know what the S-300 can do, what the S-400 and the S-500 can do. And they're blundering, and let's move the fleet in there and send in the F-18s and deploy that asset and let's pound them, you know. Then, only then do they find out, oh, they have S-400s in the field. Well, what does that mean? Well, let's see, 75,000-pound payload that has a 750-kilometer range that moves at Mach 10 at 100 feet above sea level.
And you're not going to knock it down.
You can't knock it down. You can't even see it. And when you can see it, when it breaks the horizon, from the time it breaks the horizon, if you do see it, and you say it's incoming, it's coming in at 100 feet, you have 45 seconds before impact. Yes. And before it gets there, it's deploying. It deploys a half a dozen decoys on either side, and they're all bouncing like this. At Mach 10, the new missile technology, and bear in mind that our missiles are ICBMs, you know, you're talking less than Mach 2, okay? So even if we launched everything we had and assuming that they worked and they were all 100% efficient, which I think is really begging the question, they would be easily shot out of the sky, easily shot. So in America, you have this reliance. Well, we have anti-missile systems. We have these new laser anti-missile systems. Laser anti-missile systems that are all what? Digitally based systems.
Yeah, one EMP and they won't work at all.
Nothing will work. The whole country
and then
shut down.
Think about this, not only that, think about our F-16s, practically any of our bombers, and et cetera, but especially the F-16s. This is all Chinese technology that is inside the planes to begin with. The chips are ran by the Chinese. What if the Chinese enter into the conflict and they decide to hack this system? Next thing you know, you got planes falling out of the sky.
And any of this is, and the same thing with the F-35, which is a total disaster. It's a disaster of a design. It's a disaster of a plane. And the only one who's ever built it successfully is China, who has a whole fleet of it. You know, so, I mean, the absurdity of it all. And so people do not understand how far behind we are militarily. And so we advanced tanks into the field, and we advanced artillery into the field like we're fighting World War II again. This isn't going to be World War II.
No.
And so if the neocons advance in Ukraine, and they say, and the most alarming thing in Ukraine, Stephen, is that they have expressed the Orange Revolution leadership that was engineered by George Soros, the Orange Revolution. That Orange Revolution leadership has become genocidal.
Yes, they have.
They have openly expressed, we intend to kill all of the Russian-speaking, all of the Russian nationals in Ukraine. That's genocide. Now, Americans need to understand this. We're going to come alongside a regime that has a Nazi legacy, that has openly expressed a genocidal intention, and our U.S. Congress has directly funded it.
Yes.
Talk to me about the moral issue associated with that.
And the thing is, this is what they're doing everywhere. It has become a genocide. And this is what happened that a lot of people have no idea about in Ukraine. And I've sat down with people that I know from there. Yana's father-in-law is Ukrainian. I mean, her dad is Ukrainian. You know, but I have spoke with the people. And the genocide that they were doing against the Russians, not to mention the audio that was intercepted from the U.S.-Ukrainian embassy that was going back and forth between those soldiers that were in Crimea as well. And this was what they were speaking about, to wipe out every single Russian-speaking Ukrainian. And, of course, many of those are Jews as well, as you said. Mm-hmm. So why else would the Ukrainians then have the Jews register with the government if it wasn't for intent to find, track down, and kill all the Jews?
Sure, you start with the registration, and then you begin the roundup, and then you begin the slaughter.
Exactly.
You know, alarmingly, in the United States, someone has just said that the Trump supporters need to, quote-unquote, get ready for the urn. Well, you know, the urn implies ashes.
Yes, I know.
The ashes imply a crematorium. And so you see that even in the United States, we have this same genocidal intent being expressed.
Yes.
And it's being expressed behind a color revolution, i.e. in the United States, the purple revolution. And so you see that you have a whole series of forces now that are at work in the United States. Civil war, revolution, and world war. All while the deep state is got its fingernails clawing on the cliff, trying to hold together the petrodollar and our commitments to our single largest funding agent, Saudi Arabia.
And you know one thing that it concerns me, and just kind of closing this up right now, when we look across the sea and we look at America, and we see the good old boys, as we call it in America, that have armed themselves pretty much with shotguns. I mean, I know that some of them buy the M16s, but these are all semi-automatic. They're not fully automatic, etc. But now we're having in America all kinds of shipment of weapons that have been coming into the country different ways. This purple revolution, if they get a hold of this type of weapons and stuff, the good old boys in America are going to be majorly outgunned. And of course, then they're going to blame it all on the Arabs. And I'm sure many of them will be involved in that because, Obama has not just smuggled them in, he's brought them in by the tens of thousands, not to mention the African Muslims that have come in as well, that they put in between all the different groups of African Americans there because they just blend in. They can speak English as well from Africa. Many different nations are English speaking, mm-hmm. But no one's putting two and two together. They see mm-hmm. the protests on the streets, they see mm-hmm. the violence all of a sudden that happens, they figure, oh, the black people are just going crazy. Well, I knew for a fact that Washington, from the source that I had said there, said we can't get the black people to rise up and cause a riot in this nation. So they shipped them in to make sure that they could get the ones that would incite and do that. And I'm afraid that's what America's about to come to. And that might be the time. One thought I want to just throw in here, too, in closing, to get a closing thought from you on this as well, Steve, is that while America is sending all of her tanks, all of her armored personnel carriers, all of her grad launchers, et cetera, all are being shipped out of the United States, sent all over here to the Europe theater, and suddenly a civil war breaks out in America, and a war breaks out in Europe, say, for example, with NATO going up against Russia, America now has really weakened herself to a point to where what does she have at home to defend herself if, one, a civil war breaks out and weakens the nation through civil war, and suddenly now China and Russia say, well, while they're over here trying to kill us all over here, they've been preparing to do an invasion. And I've always been concerned about that, especially with Russia's buildup up there on the North Pole, the Arctic region there, the North Pole region there, because they could come easily right over through Alaska and right on down in.
Oh, sure. They practiced with the 7 divisions and have already made landings, actual landings in Alaska without any blowback. They've been able to put troops on the ground in Alaska.
Wow.
Because Obama has debilitated the military defense system up there. You know, I grew up in Alaska. We used to confront Russian aircraft almost 100 times a year, you know, bear bombers and MiG fighters,
right,
and et cetera, that we used to have to confront. But there used to be a contingent of F-22s at Elmendorf, and as soon as Obama got done fighting Sarah Palin, because of the things she said during the campaign, he pulled it all out. He pulled all of the strong assets, pulled it out of Alaska, and just said, whatever. And so you really do have a nakedness. Now, in the United States, when you talk about this revolution, I wrote about this revolution actually yesterday and wrote about it extensively, that you could easily see situations like what you saw in Mosul and what you saw in Aleppo taking place in Phoenix or in Dearborn, Michigan, or in Chicago, where you actually see an ISIS stronghold begin to be formed. And there's no assets to go in there and take it out. And even when the federal government comes in with helicopters or whatever, they accidentally bomb wrong targets like they've been doing in Iraq. And they actually hit National Guard or domestic forces that would be trying to go in and unearth this problem. So you end up with real strongholds of ISIS in major American cities that are now capable of inflicting serious casualties on well-trained and well-developed forces. In the meantime, what we've seen a great deal of in the United States, which you may not have seen, are these, what they call the MRAP, and these fortified Hummers. They're armored vehicles, they're armored personnel carriers.
Seen pictures of those, yes.
Where you can deploy a 50 caliber on top, and they're structurally very, very strong, and you can put, you know, a dozen men inside of them. And we've seen hundreds of these being deployed in white UN colors. Primarily in the largest contingent have been in Atlanta and in the Washington, D.C. area and Maryland, and of course in Denver. So you have basically the three nerve centers for the federal government, which are going to be defended by UN troops and the blue helmets using these MRAPs. And so the rest of the country is basically going to be on its own. And so when you have a group of people who have experienced such severe brainwashing, where they were called to this purple revolution and they were going to stand up and do this, and they had an expectation, first of all, that Bernie Sanders was going to bring communism to bear. Everybody was going to get a free education, free medical care, a free job, and live in, you know, they have no idea what it is to live under communism, where you live in a rat hole and you're eating barely nothing. And they say, this is what you need. Now get in line for 10 hours to get a half a pound of green beans that somebody called coffee, and maybe once a year you get some meat. That's what the state believes you need. But they think they're going to live like Denmark, or they're going to be all sipping coffee on a cafe in Holland.
They're going to live in little bitty boxed apartments. They're going to, as Yana used to tell me about, you know, that when you worked, your paycheck was 5 pounds of sugar for the month, so many pounds of flour for the month. That was your paycheck under communism.
Yeah.
So they have no idea what they're coming to. And the ironic thing is in Europe, many of the people here live in little tiny apartments that is not much bigger than most people's living rooms in America. And then that includes their kitchen. I've seen entire families. Yana comes from this type of family.